viewers, thanks for watching my show, MAO Chat. My show allows Miss America fans and volunteers the opportunity to get to know title holders. My guests today are Miss Maine 2019, Carolyn Brady, and Miss Kansas 2019, Annika Wooton. Ladies, welcome to my show. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Okay. Thanks. You're welcome. So happy to have you. So first I want to start out talking about your friendship because, Carolyn, when I talked to you and I was looking for a guest to be on with you, you requested Miss Kansas. So I'm just curious, how did you guys become such good friends?
Well, this is a great test of our friendship because I'm going to tell the story and Annika, you interject when I say factually incorrect statements. Annika and I didn't really talk a lot before the Miss America competition. You know, okay. We weren't in any of the same filming groups at orientation. Uh-huh. We weren't roommates at any point in time.
And that's not true. We were in the Minion group together at Universal.
That's true. We were in the Minion group. See, factually correct statement. Okay. We were in the Minion group together. Uh-huh. And I remember like leaving orientation and really getting to Miss America. And there was that sort of like the one person that you were like, I don't really know if we're going to be friends. And for me, that was Kansas. And for Annika, that was me. Uh-huh. So our friendship is really such a full circle moment. But after Miss America, like in that sort of post-Christmas, before New Year's realm,
right,
we really bonded over like our recap of the experience.
Oh.
And we sort of got into this flow of just like very consistent check-ins on the, oh, so did you think that was going to happen? And what did you think about this?
Right.
And I think because our class had such a unique experience at Miss America, some people were like, I'm going to shut this out. And some people were like, that was the best. And some people were like, I feel somewhere in the middle on that spectrum. And Annika and I sort of felt the exact same way on a lot of things.
Okay.
So we're able to bond over that. And then quarantine has been like the best breeding ground for our friendship.
Okay.
We talk every single day. We did our makeup together for this podcast.
Like,
I think if I could live with her, she'd probably get frustrated. But virtually, we have the best room.
Virtually, it works great. Well, and Carolyn and I started a project together. It was Carolyn's brainchild.
Okay.
And then I kind of got looped in, and it was the Miss America how-to video series.
Oh, okay.
Which you may have seen. So we were the background duo on that, and she kind of looped me in as the VP on accident. And I was like, I mean, I can do this,
right,
but I didn't know that I was part of the spearhead. And so we just kind of jumped in full force, and that was a different element of our friendship, which continued that daily conversation. And been very unique, but was not something that started at Miss America, believe it or not.
Very cool. And I can't wait to hear more about your Miss America experience later, but I'm curious now. So can you tell us about your background and how you got involved in pageants? And Annika, we'll start with you for this
question. Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah. So I actually have been competing for over a decade in the Miss America organization. And I have only ever competed for MAO.
Okay.
But it started when someone in my local community ran one of the local competitions in Virginia, actually. And so I competed in, I think it was Miss Greater Richmond, outstanding team for my very first team competition. And competed in the team division for a few years out in Virginia, took a year off to get into college, and then chose to come back to Kansas. So I was actually born in Kansas.
Okay.
And I came back to Kansas for college and had that goal of becoming Miss Kansas. Mm-hmm. And I remember coming in my first year really thinking that I was just going to sweep the competition and win it first year out of the gate. And
okay.
Clearly that wasn't the case.
Mm-hmm.
So 7 years later, I competed every year I was eligible, thought that I had aged out. And then of course, MAO extended the age range by 1 year. So my bonus year was finally the year that did it. And then now I have another bonus year thanks to COVID.
What a story. What about you, Carolyn? How did you get involved in pageants?
So I actually started in the Miss Universe organization,
right,
and it was totally on a whim. So I had a very interesting college experience because I'm from Philadelphia initially, and I moved to Maine to go to school. And the college I went to had a student body of 1,800 people.
Okay.
And so I completed my first semester there, and I was like, okay, great. Where's everyone else?
Right.
Because the city of Philadelphia has so many people. And right. I felt like I really wanted to take advantage of an opportunity to meet more people in the state of Maine. Mm-hmm. So I signed up for the Miss Maine USA competition, really not knowing the difference between the two systems.
Oh.
And was fortunate enough to get through that weekend. And I placed in the top five. And someone who watched finals that night saw me on stage and said, "Hey, I read in your bio that you play the violin.
Mm-hmm.
Sweetheart, you're 5'4", you have a talent, this is not the place for you."
Oh.
Okay. So she suggested that I look into the Miss Maine organization.
Right.
And at the time, my very logistical brain was like, okay, so there are multiple states and I'm eligible in Maine and Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm.
And Pennsylvania gives so much more scholarship money. So why would I start in Maine?
Yeah.
So I competed in Pennsylvania for 2 years with two different local titles there. And then getting ready to graduate my senior year in college, I really decided that I wanted this to sort of be my final push for the title. And
mm-hmm.
at that time, you know, the conversations happening in our country around immigration and around diversity and acceptance,
right.
and just
yeah.
really everyone sort of coming together despite their differences,
mm-hmm.
I felt like that platform of being a state title holder would put my mission of bridging those gaps to greater use in Maine. And so I decided to compete for Miss Maine, and here we are.
That is very cool, and I can't wait to talk about your social impact initiatives a little bit later. So it took you 7 times, Annika, and then Carolyn, you competed in Miss Pennsylvania and Miss Maine. So let's talk about crowning moments. So I don't have your video, Carolyn, from when you were crowned, but I have photos of your crowning moments. And Annika, I have a video of you. So I want to show that. And then I want you to talk about how you felt, you know, during your crowning moment. So here is the crowning moment of Miss Kansas.
Ladies and gentlemen, our new Miss Kansas, Miss Wichita, Annika Wooton.
So, Annika, after 7 years, how did it feel? What were you thinking in that moment?
It was unreal. I think back to the actual competition on finals night, and we go to a top 11, and then we cut down to a top 5 for your final question. And mm-hmm. once I got to that top 5, I was at peace
oh.
with whatever was going to happen.
Wow, interesting, cool.
Yeah, I didn't feel those normal competition nerves. I just, I felt very calm. But then once I got to that final two, and you know, there's like the superstition that like your hands are on top.
Yeah, I've heard that before. Yeah.
That is the only thought that I remember thinking
okay.
is looking down and being like, my hands are on top. I was standing there with one of my absolute best friends, Madison Shonacase, and the moment that my name was called, like that's a blur. So I'm thankful that there's a video. What's funny is you see that photo, Tori is my outstanding teen, but she was also my local teen. So
oh, cool.
hearing that moment with her was the most special thing that I could have asked for. And then you see her rush to take my flowers in the video because they were leaking on my dress.
Oh.
I think if you look close enough, I'm like wiping the water off my dress and I go, does it look like I peed myself?
Oh my goodness.
Because I felt like I was completely soaked, but like clearly that didn't matter. Because I had just achieved a dream. And so I took my walk down the runway, mm-hmm. and my favorite part of that moment, which isn't captured on that video clip, is when I come back down the runway and all of the contestants come around me and give a big hug. And that just truly shows to me, I mean, I've been in this organization for such a long time,
right?
And I've had such a transformative journey.
Mm-hmm.
So to have a class that I competed with that supported me so much in that moment,
yeah.
like that's what meant the world. was coming back to embrace them at the end of the runway.
Very cool. And Carolyn, you were the first African-American to be crowned Miss Maine. So what were you thinking and what were you feeling in your crowning moment?
Well, Maine's crowning moments are unlike just about any other state because we have such a small collection of girls competing. We are second only to Wyoming, who had three people compete this past year.
Wow.
Maine had five people compete.
Okay.
So Annika's sort of vibes of like hands on top. Yeah, we all held hands in a circle, like style. Really? Like there was no like two final two.
Oh.
To hear her say when she got to the top five, she was in peace. That is so amusing to me because I entered my competition in the top five. So I walked in, I was like, yup, putting this on the resume because starting and ending top five, regardless of which way the wind blows. But for my crowning moment, it genuinely to me felt more of like a, when you receive the acceptance letter for a job.
Okay, yeah.
That's how I felt, which I guess is very much on brand with the Miss America 2.0
right.
sort of concept, because I was standing on stage. The Miss Maine competition, unlike a lot of other states, is also 2 days long when I competed.
Okay.
And so I got there on a Friday, and the entire competition, with the exception of interview, took place on that Saturday.
Uh-huh.
So I was very much in like game face mode the entire time, which obviously every young woman across the country is in getting ready to compete for their state competition. But we don't really have those similar like group bonding experiences of going to different sponsors visits and all that jazz. It's very much like you get there, you compete, someone wins, you go home. So right. when I got there, I was like, great. My job is to get there, compete, to win and go home.
Oh, okay.
And home for me won't be I'm going to go and like, yes, of course, I'm going to live my best life, but it means I'm going to be starting this job the second my name is crowned. And
right.
so when I was on stage, I was like, okay, cool. So you go into any job interview thinking that you're going to get it, obviously,
yeah.
like being prepared for the best and hoping to not get the worst.
Yeah.
And so I'm standing on stage with four other candidates because they had crowned our first runner up. And I heard my name and I was like, oh my gosh, I'm so excited. And then you can see me in the video that you can only hear because my mom dropped the phone. Actively talking to myself and saying, Carolyn, get it together. You cannot cry. This is on camera. Now, ironically enough, it's not on camera, but it was very much like, this is your job. You need to look presentable. And then went into my first interview on stage about 5 minutes later. And then obviously got started with my year. But for me, I think I really was crowned and I was like, okay, I'm going into this with the anticipation and the hope of earning this job.
Yeah.
And from the second your name is crowned, you have it. So my job at that point is to live up to that title.
Very cool. I would love to talk about talent. I love both of your talents. I think they're very interesting. So I just want to talk about both of them. Carolyn, how long have you been playing the violin?
So I say since I was five, but I haven't practiced since I was five.
Okay.
So it's a loose construct.
Mm-hmm. And then I'm going to show the videos of your talents in a few minutes. But can you tell us about speed painting, Annika? Like, how did you get into that?
Yeah, I started speed painting about 8 years ago. And it was in high school. I had a couple of great mentors in my high school theater, Keith and Kenji. And they suggested, they were like, hey, have you ever painted live on stage or thought about it? And I said, not really. And so we had planned to do a painting with the jazz band at my school.
Okay.
And this is like very on brand for me to not practice before I do a painting. I did practice for Miss America a lot, but the ones that I do in the community, it's a little bit more improv. And so going into my first speed painting, I knew what I was going to paint. I didn't necessarily know how I was going to get there.
Okay.
And so I painted my first three live speed paintings in front of my entire high school.
Okay.
And that's kind of where it started. And I had always looked for a way to present my visual art talent on stage, but wasn't sure how to package that in 90 seconds. So when it came to competing in Kansas, I sang for my first year. And then my second year, I told my director, I said, you know, if I can do a painting in front of my entire high school in 8 minutes with no practice, I do one with a lot of practice in 90 seconds.
Right.
So, that is what fueled my interest in doing speed painting for the talent competition. Now, I only did it 3 years at Kansas and then the other 4 years, and I ultimately won in Kansas singing. But I knew that once I got to Miss America,
Kansas, you sang. What did you sing at Miss Kansas?
At Miss Kansas, I sang a mashup of Don't Forget Me and Let Me Be Your Star from Smash.
Very cool. Very cool. And let's talk about playing the violin, Carolyn. How long? Oh, we talked about that before. You said you've been doing it since you were like 5. That's what you say.
That was 5.
Right. All right. So I have the videos for the viewers. Here are the talents of Miss Maine 2019, Carolyn Brady, and Miss Kansas 2019, Annika Wooton.
Roundtable rival, Carolyn Brady, Miss Maine.
I love both of your talents. Very unique, very surprising. Carolyn, I love like the showmanship, you know, how you like dance and all that. Very cool talents. Excellent, excellent, excellent. I would love to talk about your social impact initiative. So Miss Maine, yours deals with immigration. Miss Kansas, yours deals with the arts. So can you talk about those and what you've done with them? Carolyn, we'll start with you this time.
So I am incredibly fortunate to serve in my capacity as the first African-American Miss Maine, but I'm also a first-generation American on my mom's side.
Okay.
And when I competed in Pennsylvania, I actually did not have a social impact initiative about immigration. It was similar to Annika's about the arts, although the performing arts. And when I decided that I was going to compete for Miss Maine, I thought to myself, what skill set do I have that I could bring to this job of being a state title holder and mm-hmm. to the state of Maine in a way that would impact it in a way that it has not necessarily been done before. And so acknowledging my own personal background and knowing that I had a story that could really be shared with the people of Maine in a way that really is unique to them. You know, Maine has this sort of hidden immigrant population of a lot of refugees and asylum seekers as what's called a second point of entry. So they often come from Central African countries like the Democratic Republic of the Congo, Rwanda, et cetera, escaping genocide in their own countries and make their way through a different point of entry and then eventually to Maine. And I give so many props to our native-born Mainers for being so incredibly welcoming and accepting, but I felt that there was a way that we could even strengthen that bond between what's considered new Mainers, so people who are new to the state, and people who have been there for generations. And so I was hoping that with my role as Miss Maine, I would be able to bridge that gap and create a more welcoming community and educate the people that might be a part of that welcoming community while also providing resources to our new Mainers as they arrive.
Cool. Very, very great. And I think, of course, immigration has been a big issue in our country for years. And one thing that I hope is that we all can kind of come together and our country can be more united. All right, Annika, let's talk about the arts.
Yes. So I have been an artist ever since I could hold a crayon. I've been very fortunate to have a lot of different arts experiences in my life growing up and still to this day. And when I speak about the arts, it is visual arts, dancing, music, theater, I mean, anything, you know, that you can choose to express yourself through your creative outlet. And my goal really is to challenge the way people think about arts in our communities and the effect that they have not just on our individual lives and expressing ourselves, but also on our businesses and our economy. Right. And so I am, a board member with the Kansas Alliance for the Arts and Education. I'm the youngest board member we've had. And so our mission is to focus on the integration of arts K through 12. And so that starts on a school level and then to continue to challenge our policymakers and business owners on how the artists of our communities play a part in creating those businesses and the livelihood of communities. And so I talk to schools, business owners, community leaders, and just really perpetuate that the arts are a vital, vital, vital element of all of our lives in so many different facets. Mm-hmm. And so my platform, Social Impact, is titled The Artist's Fingerprint, because I truly believe that artists and creatives have their fingerprint across everything that we interact with in our lives.
Very cool. And you were the Social Impact Initiative winner. Isn't that correct?
It is correct. Yes.
Cool. Congratulations. What do you have to do for that? Do you have to like write an essay or?
Yeah, there is an application process. I think it's a series of a few different short essays, letters of recommendation, some different qualifications that you need to send in. And Kansas has historically placed well in that category, Atlas America, but we've never earned the top award. So that was very, very special.
Well, congratulations again. Cool. So let's talk about Miss America. How was your experience? Some of your memories, good, bad, and ugly, whatever you want to share. How was your experience at Miss America? Miss Kansas.
We'll start with you.
Yeah.
So,
having competed for almost a decade, this year's Miss America experience was not what I expected when I first stepped into the organization. That's not to say that it was a negative experience. It just wasn't what I think many of us expected, even when we got to Connecticut for the competition. And there were constantly surprises, new things coming up. We didn't know the format of the final competition until about 30 hours before finals night. So, you know, it was definitely a lesson in how to be flexible and gracious. And of course, it's an experience like no other. Regardless, it just wasn't necessarily the experience that I had been preparing for. And so I look back and I think of all the lessons that I learned and the friends that I gained, not just at the competition, but with Carolyn, obviously after the competition. And, you know, you have to be thankful to be able to be part of a historic time for our organization. And I truly believe in the timing of everything and that I was put here for a reason. And I may not know what that reason is until later, but the competition itself, was unique. And I think it was just a challenge that we were all prepared for challenges, maybe not this specific one or the ones that were presented to us, but we all figured out how to handle them in the moment.
Carolyn, what about you? What do you want to say about your Miss America experience?
Jason. So Miss America. You know, to piggyback on what Annika said, I think it, it was unique in that it's something that so many of us weren't expecting. I often like to characterize my Miss America experience as a game that I just did not want to play. And not one that I had signed up for. You know, most young ladies that go to the Miss America competition have competed at a local and state competition that looks very similar, if not identical, to what they will be doing on the Miss America stage. And even for the class before us, the majority of those state competitions took place after they had received the information that there would not be a swimsuit competition. And so for us, it was a full 180 of winning your state title, not knowing where you were going to Miss America, when you were going to Miss America, finding out where and when it would be taking place, not when you'd be arriving, what things that you have expected given the 100-year history of the organization and wouldn't be partaking in. And so for me, I've really thought of it as something that I just, A, was not prepared for, but B, also not necessarily something that I think I would have signed up for in terms of that specific experience. Wow. Now, obviously, you go to Miss America, that's only 1 week in the context of the 52, and in our case, many more than that, weeks that you will spend as a state title holder. Right. So I think for a lot of us, if you think about it in the grand scheme of things, like, yes, Miss America is supposed to be that best experience of your year, but I would never opt out of going because that would mean that I wouldn't get to be Miss Maine, and that is a job that I will cherish for the rest of my life and that I genuinely believe will eventually have been one of the most transformative years of my life. But when you think about it in the grand scheme of things, like, if you asked all 51 of us in June of 2019 who thought there would be no evening gowns for walk-on, who thought that we would have a welcome ceremony in the form that we did. Usually you have young ladies that are all out on a stage that are able to present themselves. You know, that's one of the biggest things about Miss America is that it's a networking opportunity for everyone, regardless of whether or not you win that job. You should be able to go there. There should be someone in the audience who says, hey, like, let's just say in a foreign world, Camille didn't win. Someone should have been able to sit there, say, I see this young woman performing a science talent and I want to hire her for a biochemistry firm of some form. And she can walk away from that saying, this was a great opportunity for me to share my talent and my own background without necessarily walking away with the crown. And unfortunately, the way Miss America was set up this year is that you got significantly less impact and face time with the candidates that were not selected for those seven. I personally, as one of Annika's best friends, can say I didn't see her say a single word on national television. And she, that's a lie, after her name. And she was in the top 15. And that is something that I feel is really such a sad point, because we have young women that work their lives to get to this stage. And we are there for a week and a half, if not more, other years. And they should have just as many opportunities to showcase not necessarily why they would be the best candidate for this job, but why they would be an amazing candidate for any job, especially given their own strengths and pursuits. And that's something that I feel like we really didn't have the opportunity to do this year.
I've interviewed many state title holders, and I was surprised when I learned that you guys didn't know the format and things like that. You know, I was just surprised because I would have thought that they would have had that worked out way before you got there, you know, and gave you like an itinerary and told you what was going on. So yeah, I was surprised. And back to your point about networking and showing off, like, I have heard Miss USA people say that many times a lot of those girls have contracts, you know, after, by the time the week is over, because there are people there and they, you know, they meet them and all that, and then they offer them jobs and stuff, you know. So what would you guys like to see in the future? You know, the 100th anniversary is coming up, and, you know, because of COVID, we're not having one this year. So, you know, they have more time to plan, and, you know, I hope it's successful in the future. But what are some things? I know probably you would like to see, like, a welcoming ceremony at the next one.
I don't even know. You go.
My hope is, because we are approaching such a remarkable year, the 100th anniversary, and because we have all this extra time to plan and get ready, is that there is a structure and a communication structure in place, not just for the women going to the national organization, but how that trickles down to the local level. Because ultimately, I think a lot of young women are preparing as if they're preparing for Miss America when they have their local titles or they're going into their state competition. Like Carolyn said, what we competed in at a local level was not what was reflected in Miss America. So if we have this time to set up the structure and set up that foundation so that it can be communicated on all levels, I think we will have a much more successful group of young women going into that 100th anniversary. Mm-hmm. And then past that, I hope that it's just a celebration for everyone. I hope that, like Carolyn mentioned, the girls have opportunities to network and be featured and be celebrated for getting that far.
Yeah.
One of the things that I was looking forward to the absolute most, regardless of the competition, was the Show Us Your Shoes parade. Mm-hmm. And I had my dress and my shoes and my whole concept planned 4 years. Like, I made my shoes 4 years ago.
Oh,
ready
my gosh.
To go.
Wow.
And we didn't have a Show Us Your Shoes parade. So yeah. it's the little things like that and those little elements of tradition that we can continue mm-hmm. while going into this 2.0 branding that I think will still make it feel like a very special experience no matter where you place in the competition.
Yeah, I think most Miss America fans and volunteers, and I would I guess you guys too, you know, when they went from 15 to 7 without anything in between, you know, most of us didn't like that. So yeah, because that would have given you more time to talk or, you know, something, you know, we could have gotten to know you a little bit better. What did you think of the reality show format with the three judges giving you feedback, like right there on stage? Did you like that, or would you prefer like the traditional way better, where they just announce who made the cut to the next, you know, competition?
Well, considering neither of us made it to that point where we had that interaction,
yeah.
It's mostly, you know, speculation. I'll say I would have loved hearing feedback on my painting. And
oh.
I painted Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was so ready to hear what Karamo would say about that. Like, I was really, really excited to hear their reactions. That being said, we have prepared so long for that one moment on stage or those few moments on stage. And at that point, you can't really change anything.
Mm-hmm.
So having a reaction or a commentary, I think, was a really cool element to show that dialogue between the judges and the candidates, kind of see where they stood. But in terms of giving suggestions on what to do better for next time,
yeah.
Like, there's not a next time.
Right.
So I think, like, again, I would have loved to hear the reactions when I spun that painting around, but didn't get to that point.
Yeah.
And so I kind of think that using that time to have a little bit of banter that, my opinion, didn't really do much since there wasn't a next round in each category.
Right.
We could have used that time to highlight more candidates, and maybe you could have had the rest of the top 15 featured instead of having the time for critique.
Right. And when you spun your painting around, I was just like, wow, because I immediately knew who it was. And then I'm like, oh my God, it's upside down. Like, she kind of painted upside down, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
So Carolyn, what is something you would like to see, or do you have any comments? What would you like to see, like, at the next Miss America?
I agree with Annika 100%. I think going, having this opportunity to plan for the next year is really going to be a huge service to the organization
mm-hmm.
and ensuring that it can trickle down to the state and local levels. You know, we have so many young women who are waiting to compete at their state competitions because they won a local title in anticipation for this next year.
Right.
So even if you can't change what their local experience will look like, hopefully their state and national experience can be reflective of each other. And even if it's not the case that they look exactly identical,
mm-hmm.
I think having information that they won't in advance
yeah.
could be really beneficial to everyone who's participating. You know, going back to Annika's Show Me Your Shoes parade
mm-hmm.
comment, I can totally empathize with the people that have had that planned out for years. And even if we don't necessarily move forward with ideas that are identical to that and maybe something more reflective of a 2.0 ideal,
mm-hmm.
I think we can have experiences that are not just the competition week itself. I left my room, unless to go to rehearsal, for maybe three things. That was media, Chick-fil-A, because I was accompanied by staff, and I believe it was visitation. And there were very few times when we were not just presenting what was part of the competition itself. And so as many opportunities as we could have to not necessarily do a Show Me Your Shoes parade or a spa day or things that have happened in the past, but to showcase what makes us one of 51 qualified women to be on a national stage.
Right.
And really highlighting what this organization has to share, more of that.
Mm-hmm.
More highlighting the sparkle, I think, is what we need. Feel free to
okay.
bring that.
Yeah. I'm just curious. I'm just going to throw this question in. But how do you feel about the lifestyle and fitness category, the swimsuit? Are you glad that it's gone? Or do you think it's a place for it? Or are you on the fence about it? Carolyn, we'll start with you this time. How do you feel about that?
You know, I have only competed in this organization for 3 years, and so I have a significantly shorter time frame in the organization with respect to swimsuit, non-swimsuit. By the time I am done, I will have spent equally as much time having competed in lifestyle and swimsuit as I will have not.
Okay.
And so not as wide of a group of experiences. However, I think that it does have its pros and cons. I believe that women should not be judged on their body, but I do believe that a healthy lifestyle is essential important to being a successful state title holder.
Right.
And to think how many of us still have exercise sponsors, still have lifestyle and fitness aspects of the job,
right,
I think is still critical to being a state title holder. And so maybe if we can find a way to still enforce that part of the judging criteria without necessarily objectifying women as much would be a great balance.
Cool. Annika, what do you think?
Yeah, I completely echo what Carolyn said. Sorry, there's motorcycles going by outside my balcony. I don't know if y'all can hear that.
Yeah.
I did compete in lifestyle and fitness for a number of years. And I will say that as an art kid, I am not athletic,
okay,
did not, you know, go to the gym by choice. And so because I had to be on stage in a swimsuit for a few seconds, once or twice a year, I had to learn how to take care of myself in a different way.
Okay.
And I give credit to that element of the competition, to figuring out how to take care of my body in a healthy way in the middle of college, you know, when you've got wonderful dining hall food.
Yeah.
but in the same light, being in a swimsuit has nothing to do with being Miss America,
okay,
but being healthy and having that kind of discipline and determination and being able to present yourself in a healthy way, no matter, not just present yourself, but live your life in a healthy way, no matter what that looks like to you. I think that the shift of removing that element of competition could have been, again, communicated and branded better. Right. I heard from some people that it wasn't so much, oh, this is inclusive of people who can come in that maybe weren't comfortable before, but rather we don't want to see those kinds of bodies in swimsuits. Oh. So I think that the communication surrounding that removal or shifting that competition to still represent some kind of lifestyle and fitness in a way that did embody a breadth of what health looked like would have been maybe a better way to go, or a new way that we can go in the future.
Very cool. I think I have two more questions left. The first question is, so what is next for you after you give up the crown? What are some of your future ambitions and desires? And Annika, we'll start with you.
Well, if you had asked me that, you know, 4 months ago, I would have had a drastically different answer.
Okay.
And right now, I'm not sure what that looks like, honestly. Oh, okay. I have gained so many incredible experiences and skills through this organization. I was just talking with one of my friends yesterday. I was like, okay, so what is the job title for public speaking, traveling, singing, speed painting, working with the community, doing social media? Like, how is that all encompassed in something that's not under a crown?
Oh, yeah.
And so many other of those nuances and the things that I found that I enjoy as a part of this, aspects of this job. But my background is in illustration and design.
Mm-hmm.
Prior to Miss Kansas, I was working as a visual designer at Garmin International. So I imagine that going forward, I will still be doing something creative. I will still be doing something public facing, working with communities and bettering the spaces that I'm a part of.
Very cool. Maybe you can be a motivational speaker. That just popped into my head.
Yeah. Cool.
Carolyn, what about you? What's next for you? Some of your future goals?
Well, you know, converse to Annika, which is traditional in our friendship, have a 50-year plan. So I will hopefully finish my year as Miss Maine, which is concurrent with my second term of serving as an AmeriCorps member.
Oh.
And then ideally I will go to some form of foreign service or international affairs grad school, which will last 2 to 3 years. From there, I'll spend about 2 to 3 years doing some other sort of grassroots public service work, similar to AmeriCorps, but hopefully on an international level. So with the United Nations, perhaps in the countries in which I hope to serve. And from there, or while I'm doing that, I will begin the application process to the Foreign Service through the State Department.
Mm-hmm.
Now, ideally, I would be placed either in East Asia, as I minored in Chinese, or in Central Africa, where the majority of the refugee and humanitarian crises take place. And I will have some sort of first term of service that will likely be in a place where you get to learn a lot about a part of the State Department you didn't know about, and then continue to 2 to 3 terms. And then in my like 50s-ish, I will hopefully graduate in that from that term from the Foreign Service and move back to the domestic side of the State Department, either working in UN consultant-based work or continuing to serve for the State Department, hopefully working my way all the way up to Secretary of State, only under a president, which I feel confident in working for. And then I will retire early and go to all of my grandchildren's soccer games.
Very, very cool. So you know Mandarin, I guess.
Just yo EDR.
All right. Well, I was going to say ni hao. That's what I was going to say to you. So Miss Montana recently crowned a new winner. I believe I was told that there's going to be another competition in October. And then hopefully next year, you know, all the states will start having competitions. So my last question to you ladies is, what advice would you give for local title holders who are currently competing or about to compete for their state titles? What advice would you give them for being successful in Miss America 2.0?
I would say to set goals for yourself that have nothing to do with winning the state or national title.
Okay.
The Miss America organization is such a unique experience. And granted, you know, the three of us are so involved, so we know so many women who are successful, but in reality, the number of women who have their lives touched by this organization is a very small, you know, percentage. But I think that sometimes we get so focused on winning that title or getting to that top spot that we don't consider the value of the experiences and the opportunities that make up the rest of the journey.
Okay.
And especially going into the Miss America competition and not knowing necessarily what it will look like. Same thing with the state level, honestly, with this entire year, not knowing the things that we can't control.
Okay.
To be able to set goals for yourself and intentions that, you know, are parallel to what you're doing within the competition, but have nothing to do with placing or winning, I think that that will make the entire experience so much more valuable, both in the moments that you're living and as you're reflecting on what you gained from your time competing with us.
Very nice. Carolyn, what advice would you give to girls who are currently competing?
I think the key to Miss America 2.0 is finding what about you can serve this role, this organization, this job, whether that's a state, local, or national title, mm-hmm. in a way that everyone else cannot.
Okay.
And so when you think about Miss America, at least our year, and all the 51 women that were on that stage, we often say that any one of us can be Miss America. And while that is the cliche saying, I think it is so incredibly true, because if you're going for a young woman who can advance STEM curriculum and who is not your traditional pageant girl and who has come from not necessarily the upbringing and teen to Miss background, but it's still gonna push an agenda that's women first, you've got Camille. But if you're going for a speed painter that's gonna speak to the Midwest, that's going to highlight what it means to be a servant to this organization for over a decade,
right,
and then still speak to that, you've got Annika. And then obviously for so many other purposes, we have so many other young women that could fulfill that.
Yeah.
And I think that what the judges are going to be looking for, at least what I would recommend they look for, if it was up to me, which it's not, it's that you find people that can serve their own personal platform in the best possible way.
Mm-hmm.
And I really hope that so many of the local candidates that are going out for state titles in the coming months and upcoming year is that they will find that thing that's so special to them, that's their specific story, and figure out how they can highlight that to change the lives of others.
Very, very nice. Well, I would like to thank you ladies for speaking to me today and being on my show. I really appreciate you guys, you know, expressing yourselves, giving your opinions, and I hope that everyone who watches just enjoys it and takes it in and takes your advice. And once again, I want to thank you so much. So
yeah, thank you for having us.
Appreciate it. My pleasure. And I hope you have a good day.
Thanks. You too.
All right. To the viewers, once again, I would like to thank you for watching my show. I hope that you enjoyed hearing from Miss Maine and Miss Kansas. Next week on my show, I will have Miss America 2013, Mallory Hagan. And the week after that, I will have Miss America 1999, Nicole Johnson. If anybody would like to reach out to me, you can email me, jasontimothyrobinson@gmail.com. You can donate to my Cash App, $JTROBIN, or you can find me on Facebook in the group MAO Chat and donate to my show, MAO Chat. Once again, viewers, I hope you enjoy watching the show. Thanks for watching. Have a good day.